Thank you for the introduction. First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers of this conference for bringing us all here to discuss, I think, one of the most interesting and urgent issues for all of us at this moment in world history. I don't think that's hyperbole. I also would like to offer my thanks to the General Secretary, Rex Abbas, to honorable ministers and ambassadors, to His All Holiness, Ecumenical Patriarch Bartholomew, and Your Eminence is here representing the Ecumenical Throne, to Archbishop Hieronymus in absentia, and his representative Father at Saladin and Saladitis, and also His Eminences who are here, to Rector Diogonos, and to all distinguished participants. And also, again, a special thanks to the organizers for having the vision to put this conference together. I'm going to turn immediately to my topic because the time is tight and my task is formidable. I was asked within the first 30 minutes to set the parameters for our deliberations this evening and tomorrow. We're all here because of our shared view that the binary categories of secular and religious, profane and sacred, make no sense in a world, to paraphrase former U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry, where people of all faiths are immigrating and mingling like never before, where we are a global community, and where I would add, the dynamics of religious pluralism are as real as those forces who are committed to religious homogenization. Simply put, in today's world, as Secretary Kerry summed up, we need more religion our peril. And all of us here today undoubtedly agree that religious ideas, institutions, and actors have enormous capacity to affect peace through dialogue and cooperation in order to respond to the existential issues that are planetary in scope of our time. Or, alternatively, those speaking and acting in the name of religion can do the opposite. So within this context, our questions over the next 2 days, I think, are as follows. How do religion and diplomacy intersect? What is religious diplomacy? Who are the practitioners of religious diplomacy? Does religious diplomacy mean the same thing to all practitioners? How can religious diplomacy contribute to dialogue and peace in our time? Now, time constraints obviously make it impossible for me to answer all of those questions, rather than a very general set of ideas. But I do want to try and establish some useful reference points and a framework for us as we go forward. So I'm going to organize my time as follows. First, I want to speak about power. And specifically, I'll talk about one type of power, known as soft power. Second, I'd like to explore how soft power, God, and geopolitics related to religious diplomacy. More specifically, I want to suggest that religious diplomacy is a form of soft power, and indeed, that practitioners of religious diplomacy recognize it as such. They also understand that religious diplomacy involves the sacred and God, and they understand that the sacred and God transcend the formal boundaries of geography. So religious diplomacy actually changes the meaning of the terrain of geopolitics. And then by way of conclusion, I want to touch very, very briefly on just a few concrete examples of religious diplomacy as soft power to show how the practitioners of religious diplomacy understand full well that God and religion transcend and alter the formal boundaries of geopolitics and the world in which we live. So let me turn now to part one and the concept of soft power. I think it's fair to say that since the end of the Cold War, the terms hard power, soft power, and smart power have been mainstreamed from the highly specialized international relations discourse into the popular lexicon. There's actually a very large social science conceptual, definitional, and operational challenges of all three. So let me simplify. Any leader, whether political, religious, or otherwise, recognizes that power is the ability to influence another to act in ways in which that other would not have acted. In other words, power is the ability to influence the behavior of others to get the outcome that one wants. Accordingly, there are three types of power: hard, soft, and smart. Soft power will concern us. Probably the most influential voices in mainstreaming the typology of power that I just mentioned have been Harvard University political scientist Joseph Nye, along with former U.S. Deputy Secretary of State Richard Armitage and former U.S. Secretary of State Hillary Clinton. In his 1990 book on soft power, Nye began with hard power and then moved to soft and finally smart. He defined hard power as power that is coercive. Hard power is coercive. In other words, it entails the ability of states and non-state actors to use coercion, either military money or force, or economic incentives, to get other states to behave as one wants. The resources of hard power, therefore, are material. They're mainly military and economic. In contrast, Nye tells us, soft power involves the state's ability to accomplish its goals and obtain its outcomes through attraction and persuasion. He even uses the term seduction. By shaping the preferences of others in ways that are not coercive, but in ways that are cooperative. By persuading others to want to be like you, to want the outcomes that you want, states and non-state actors, including religion, understand that soft power functions by attraction and involves, therefore, the use of resources that are appealing to others, specifically ideas, values, norms, culture, and all those intangible assets that are attractive enough to change preferences and therefore behaviors. Now finally, smart power. Smart power is a term that moved again from a highly specialized domain of the academy into policy making and into the public sphere. It was globally mediatized, I would say, when Hillary Clinton used it in her confirmation hearings as U.S. Secretary of State in 2009. Smart power entails the capacity of an actor to combine elements of hard power and soft power in ways that are mutually reinforcing. And practitioners of smart power, therefore, employ both coercive, hard, and co-opted, soft power resources and assets to produce the outcomes that they want in international relations. So, how do states and non-state actors use all of these assets? In the case of hard power, by imposing or threatening to impose them, by force, military action, intervention, or the threat of those things. They do it individually or through formal alliances or other forms of cooperation, in diplomatic engagements, and in other venues of dialogue. They do it through incentivization, in other words, providing economic assistance, providing humanitarian support, providing foreign aid. In the case of soft power, they mobilize their resources by taking a lead or by leading by example. Actions by leaders of their institutions are explicitly defined by their normative commitments, by what should be. They explicitly state that they are acting on the basis of what should be. These, again, apply values, beliefs, ideas, philosophies, culture, civilizational resources. And soft power occurs by accruing moral authority and legitimacy on the basis of consistent matching of these normative commitments to action. In other words, to put it in the vernacular, no hypocrisy. And then finally, in the case of smart power, actors amass smart power and they use it by analyzing the context and the capabilities of other states or non-state actors' interests, in order to optimally combine hard and soft power resources to get the outcome that they want. So what does all of this have to do with religious diplomacy? How does this typology of power, and especially the category of soft power, relate to God, geopolitics, and to religious diplomacy? I'll turn here to the second part of my talk. My very straightforward claim is that religious diplomacy is a form of soft power. And it's being recognized as such by both states and by religious groups and communities, as well by a host of multilateral actors that are both state-centered and religion-centered. Some examples would include the United Nations, the World Bank, the European Union, the World Council of Churches, the Organization of Islamic Cooperation, the World Conference on Religions for Peace, NATO, and others. The recognition of religious diplomacy is a crucial form of soft power grows out of a shared awareness by states and religions that God transcends geopolitics, as I said earlier, and therefore that God and the sacred are not bordered and bounded by physical geography. And in this sense, the appeals to, the beliefs in, and the actions in the name of the sacred transform geopolitics, or transform the links between geography on the one hand politics on the other. Because think about it, beliefs, values, norms, cultures, civilizations that are rooted in God and the sacred, they function both within states, within the territorial boundaries of states, but they also function across those boundaries. They function in what people call the liminal spaces. So legal and physical geographies of our world cannot contain religious diplomacy. And in this regard, and our earlier speakers who introduced us this evening, they emphasized this, that therefore religion is a source of both order or disruption, peace or violence, in a state-organized system. Because religion adheres to this state-organized system that operates beyond it. Now, returning to the initial definition of power as the ability to influence another, to act in ways that that entity would not have acted otherwise. Or as Max Weber, the famous sociologist, put it, power is the ability to exercise one's will over others. State makers and religious leaders have come to view religion as one of the most valuable equities, one of the most valuable equities in accruing and multiplying soft power in our world. And also, for eroding and corroding and undermining the soft power of others. So, religious diplomacy is a crucial soft power tool in our time. Now, if we understand it as a form of soft power, we then need to think about who are the agents, who are the actors, who are the participants, the practitioners of religious diplomacy. Where do they engage? How do they engage? So to provide a framework for our subsequent discussions, let me emphasize these few points. First of all, the practitioners of religious diplomacy as a soft power tool, as I said earlier, involve both leaders of states, leaders of religious groups as well. The context for their practice of religious diplomacy is within states, within religious institutions, and also involves individual and multilateral and or interfaith formats. I also want to emphasize a second point. The practitioners of religious diplomacy engage in various combinations and with various objectives when it comes to their own goals. In other words, and I think this is an important point for us and it certainly makes sense for anyone who works on global Orthodox, but we can apply this more generally. States and religious leaders engage in religious diplomacy for objectives that may be secular, for objectives that may be religious, and also to change the balance of power between and among states, but oftentimes between faith communities or within their own religious communities. And I emphasize this diversity because it's crucial to recognize that when we think about religious diplomacy, we may focus on the state religion fulcrum as the center of religious diplomacy, but just as frequently, again, it's clear that that state religion fulcrum allows for the practice of religious diplomacy that may have religious objectives and may be focused on religious communities, or that may be focused on states. So we're talking about what international relations practitioners would call a multi-level game, where dialogue and cooperation are designed with multiple goals of attraction, co-option, or again, seduction. Now, when it comes to action on issues of climate change and disruption, combating modern slavery, reducing global hunger and poverty, or ending the nuclear world, religious diplomacy involving states and religious communities is usually designed to attract both states and religious actors to commit to these shared objectives. So when it comes to the actors we need persuading, or attracting, or co-opting, states and religious leaders, political and religious leaders, use diplomacy to persuade other states and other faith communities. State leaders recognize the soft power of religious communities to mobilize their own communities using the wellspring of their ideas, their teachings, their practices about things like environmental stewardship, human dignity, nonviolence, acceptance, toleration, and pluralism with their own followers so they can speak to their own faith communities who at the same time are also citizens of states, and they can persuade them, they can cooperate to adopt and support state organized practices that can contribute to resolving the kinds of problems that I just described. Conversely, religious leaders understand that states are crucial for shaping the structural conditions of democratic political regimes, or their opposite, authoritarian and totalitarian regimes, of structuring economic opportunity and equity, and also of structuring the security environments that affect faith communities' believers. So religious communities, through religious diplomacy, work with states to produce outcomes that are good for their own believers as well. So, to sum up the discussion of religious diplomacy as a form of soft power, it should be obvious, I think, to all of us that the significance of soft power has increased exponentially in the post-Cold War globalized international order. We live in a world of chaotically and diffusely distributed hard power, uneven distribution of hard power. Some states have enormous wealth, some states have enormous military might, others have less of those. So soft power then becomes more important in trying to resolve the issues that can destroy or that can sustain our entire planet and beyond that, the entire creative order. And that's where religious diplomacy as a soft power tool has a very important role to play. Let me conclude now with three small examples, I think, that illustrate the different actors involved in religious diplomacy, the different venues of religious diplomacy, and the different interests of the practice of religious diplomacy, sometimes for peace and sometimes not for peace. Example one is the United States. I began my presentation with a quote from former U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry, and his observations in 2013, I think, point to the U.S.'s recognition of the profound importance of religious diplomacy as a form of soft power. The United States understands religious diplomacy as a way for America to achieve its national security and strategic interests worldwide, but also for advancing America's declared values and commitments to universal human rights that we all know are articulated in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights in 1948, of which, by the way, Orthodox Christian played a very important role in the drafting of that declaration. Charles Lally, the deceased Lebanese Orthodox Christian, Greek Orthodox Christian from London. Now, since 1998, when the U.S. Congress unanimously passed the International Religious Freedom Act, American presidents across party lines have committed the United States to religious diplomacy by building a range of foreign policy tools and frameworks that fall under that umbrella. For example, the Office of International Religious Freedom, the State Department, the U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom, from which I served for 8 years, which reports to the President, the White, the Secretary of State, and Congress on religious freedom violations around the world, the National Security Advisor on International Religious Freedom, the Ambassador at Large for International Religious Freedom, the Special Advisor for Religious Minorities in the Near East and South Central Asia, the Office of Faith-Based and Community Initiatives, and the U.S. Agency for International Development Special Advisor for Minority Assistance, namely Genocide Minorities, Shia Christians and Yazidis in Iraq, and the Office of Religion and Global Affairs. These are just a few of the tools that have now been created within the formal institutional architectures of U.S. foreign policy to engage with religious communities and to deal with issues whose resolution the United States believes it is crucial for religious communities to participate. Now, a second example that I would give is Saudi Arabia. And Saudi Arabia understands religious diplomacy as a soft power tool. The Kingdom of Saudi Arabia is an Islamic theocracy, and it has religious diplomacy built into its own foreign policy. The country's political leadership has long understood engagement by and with religious leaders as a soft power tool to accomplish the objectives of the Saudi royal family and of the Wahhabi religious establishment, namely to solidify Saudi Arabia's position as the unrivaled leader of the global Muslim Ummah or community. Now, in the case of Saudi Arabia's approach to religious diplomacy, their government's engagement includes interaction with other states, leadership of the OIC, the Organization of Islamic Cooperation, which is headquartered in Jeddah, in Saudi Arabia, and also interactions with other Muslim communities and groups all over the world. And in this regard, we see religious diplomacy for the Saudis operating at those two levels I discussed, religion state, but also within religion. Because again, one of the goals of religious diplomacy for Saudi Arabia is to ensure that the Saudi interpretation of Sunni Islam is unchallenged by other Sunni groups, certainly by Shia and by what they consider non-conforming Muslim groups. And some of the tools of Saudi's religious diplomacy as soft power include the export of Sunni Islamism in textbooks, mosques, madrasas, mullahs, giving programmatic funding to research centers from Asia to Europe to North America to Africa, and also active participation in leading the OIC voting body in multilateral organizations like the United Nations Human Rights Council. So here's a second, and here's my third and final example of religious diplomacy, because we see it all around us and we may not recognize it. The third example concerns the World Bank, perhaps a counterintuitive example. The World Bank established a faith initiative team in a division of faith and a global engagement and partnerships group. And that division of faith has a vital engagement with faith-based and religious organizations that recognize that those organizations, those religious organizations, are oftentimes doing the essential work on the front lines of combating extreme poverty, protecting the vulnerable, delivering humanitarian and medical assistance, and alleviating human suffering. So the Faith Initiative team at the World Bank practices religious diplomacy as a form of soft power. And this team of World Bank bankers, financial experts, and development experts actively engages with faith communities around the world. These are only three examples of religious diplomacy as a soft power tool. In other words, as a tool for attraction, co-optation, rather than a tool for coercion. They're all quite different. I've given you very, very general examples, very, very general pieces of information for each one, but I think they're instructive. And I hope that even with this short introduction, I've helped us to perhaps set the parameters with some useful reference points for the remainder of our deliberations, showing how religious diplomacy as a crucial form of soft power can be effectively utilized by states and my religious institutions, by political leaders and my religious leaders, within multilateral contexts, to promote either dialogue and peace in our time, or to be complicit in the disruption of our world. Hopefully, it's the former. Thank you.